Blog Talk Radio.
You're quite hostile.
I got a right to be hostile. Man, my people been persecuted.
Yeah, I'm tired of it. I'm black and Jewish. Get into it.
Revolution is not the best. It's a crime.
Why Jesus down?
Something is wrong.
Do the research like we do the research, and you'll be convinced also.
Turn off the house while I live in Atlanta.
Continue to raise the intellect and the consciousness of the human family.
Professor Griff knows.
So I ain't no toast.
One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. Today, Tuesday, right? Sure?
Yes, sir.
All right. Starting off with a bad start.
A great start.
It's NMEMINDZ Radio on the Mind, not a Blog Talk. Radio network where matters of the mind matter. Greetings, family, peace, Hotep, Shalom. Assalamu alaikum, Abidia, Foria, Alafia, Black Power. And as Pam Africa says, on the move, and welcome to another edition of NMEMINDZ Radio with your host, Professor Griff, and Ms. ZaZa Ali.
Yes, peace to the gods and goddesses, peace to the RBG, peace to the Pan-African family, peace to the Rastafari, the Black Nationalists, the Moors, the Hebrew Israelites, the Native Americans, the Afro-Latinos, and the original family covering every 196,940,000 square miles of planet Earth.
All right. Let me ask you something. The volume on your computer, is it up?
Is the volume on my computer up? Let me check that, sir. Yes, sir.
All right. Ooh. This is the show where minds produce minds that produce minds that produce great minds, because minds matter. We are souls in search of souls that are like mine, like mine. This show and every show is dedicated to all those that are dedicated. As taught to us by our good brother, Dr. Reverend Phil Valentine.
We were also taught by Sister Amy Garvey to stand on our own 2 feet and fight like hell for our place in this world.
And we're definitely standing on the verge of getting it on to bring about a revolution of the mind, that is, because minds matter. Yes, the revolution is complete, constructive, conscious, cosmic change given to us by our good brother, Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad.
And as the African proverb states, revolution is when women give birth to men. It is through the womb that man perfects himself, and it is through love that man is truly transformed.
You can be whatever you want to be in this world's life on your way to becoming gods and goddesses, having a human experience called you, as taught to us by Professor James Small.
And that was also taught to us by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who taught us that to find God, we must look within. Heaven and hell is a physical place. Wait. Heaven and hell is not
a physical place.
What the hell am I saying? Heaven and hell is a state of mind, not an actual physical place, family. Therefore, we build minds and hold truth at falsehood, destroying and rebuilding.
Once again, this is NMEMINDZ Radio on the Minds Matter Blog Talk Radio Network, where matters of the mind matter. Our aim and our mission
is to raise a vibrational pitch of our thinking into the mind of the Creator, as taught to us by Tanetta Muhammad.
And also to raise the consciousness level of the human family and replace racism, white supremacy with justice, so that we can live in peace on this planet that we affectionately call Earth.
The call-in number is 347-633-9644. Hit us up. We definitely want to talk to you and know what's on your mind.
So in the spirit of our ancestors, to whom shoulders we stand on, we would simply like to say to you and have you say with us, Ashe. Ashe simply means so be it. And with that said, we want to call on the spirit of a great mother, when cats in the rap community and hip-hop community say mom, which was befitting if you knew what it meant. But calling on a queen mother, we affectionately call her Queen Mother Moore, and calling on this beautiful woman's spirit who said to us, they owe us more than they could ever pay. I don't know what it is that we keep expecting from these people. They stole our language. They stole our culture. They stole our mothers and fathers and took our names from us. At least go back and get your name and your birthright
right
back. All right? So in the spirit of our sister and our elders and our ancestors, pardon me, we want to call on the spirit of our good sister, Queen Mother Moore.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And in the spirit of one of the great sports athletes. Not the way I wanted to say that. I rehearsed that in my head, and that's not the way it came out. But trailblazing athlete Althea Gibson became the first great African-American player in women's tennis. Raised primarily in the Harlem section of New York City, she won a string of American Tennis Association titles on the African-American circuit. After being allowed entry into the major tournaments, she became the first black player to win Wimbledon and the French and U.S. Open titles. Gibson turned professional in 1959 and made more history by becoming the first African-American competitor on the Women's Pro Golf Tour in the 1960s.
Wow.
She was inducted into the International Tennis Hall of Fame in 1971 and later served as Commissioner of Athletics for the state of New Jersey. Now, if you are a tennis sports fan like me, there are certain sports that you know are extremely racist. Tennis is one of them. So for this sister in the 1950s,
I thought you were gonna say something else. Go ahead.
for this sister in the 1950s to kick the door in for the Williams sisters the way she did, and be able to maintain her dignity and self-respect and be one of the best that ever played the game, we definitely owe our honor and our respect to this sister. She said, "I want the public to remember me as they knew me: athletic, smart, and healthy. Remember me strong and tough and quick, fleet of foot and tenacious." So in the name and in the honor and in the memory and in respect of the legacy of Sister Althea Gibson, we say Ashe.
Ashe. And in the spirit of all those prophetess, messengers, and guides who came to us in the spirit of great women, to all those unknown soldiers that have fought, bled, and died for the freedom, liberation, and struggle of our people here in the wilderness of North America and throughout the black African diaspora, we'd like to say three times Ashe.
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 Ashe-o.
Ashe-o.
If you'd like to contact us, you can hit me up, Professor Griff. Just tweet me at RealProfGriff. Or you could just email me at ProfessorGriff, PE@gmail.com. You can text me, 678-557-2919.
You can hit me up on Facebook at Zaza, Z-A-Z-A, Najaja, Zaza Ali. Our Enemy Minds Facebook page is NMEMINDZ Radio. You can also hit us on Twitter at Enemy Minds Radio. My website to purchase Black Matters is blackmattersbook.com. And, of course, what else? I feel like I'm forgetting something.
The YouTube channel, which we're...
I never say the YouTube channel. Enemy Minds TV.
Yes.
I need to start remembering that.
Right.
Go to YouTube and subscribe to our page, Enemy Minds TV. It is not that active. I've put up a few videos, but in the short term, we are definitely going to be pumping and promoting that as we build our website. It's going to be some major things going on.
Right.
So definitely go and subscribe to Enemy Minds TV when you have a chance.
All right. Shout out to my good brother, Black Dot.
Yes.
Thank you, Black Dot, for being the glue.
Thank you.
Really appreciate you. And, you know, it takes a lot to put your life on pause for a minute to take time for other people. But we really appreciate you, man. Love you to life. Still not letting you off the hook about that book, though.
Hey, now that I see what it takes,
oh, yeah.
I got a whole different level of respect.
Right.
Not for people who just put out fluff to say they wrote books. You know,
right.
I wrote 1,000 books. Okay, cool. But for those who take the craft seriously,
yep,
and who really put their heart and soul into whatever your topic is, I've got to tip my hat to you. It is no
yeah
joke. And then the tension that comes with, oh, my God, now people have my work.
Be a part
what are they
of your
thinking
mind, part of your spirit,
they have a
part
of your
you
mind, part of you. What are they thinking? I wrote.
Right.
Well, go ahead. I'm sorry. You.
No, go on.
No, because you want to finish your shout outs, and then I'll go into that when I do mine.
Okay. Shout out to my good brother, Darren Muhammad. John Trey, man, keep your head up. We're going to make that happen.
Yes.
Khalid El Hakim and Misan all the way from the D, man. Me, son, and Brother Emperor said, listen, man, I know you're going to a corny chiropractor. I know you're getting some corny therapy.
Get your weight up, homie.
Right. So they said, look, you need to be here training. So they invited me to come to Detroit and St. Louis.
Yeah, and just to let everybody know, I have been adamant about pressuring you to get you to do a martial arts DVD for young people,
mm-hmm.
something that is interactive, something that is fun, which, of course, we know you are the master of fun and jokes. I think it would just be so hot for Professor Griff of Public Enemy, world-renowned jokester and comedian
right now, martial artist. Right now, I'd be on film with a cane, man.
No, I'm just saying, like, I'm putting it out there.
When I get well.
I'm putting it out there into the universe.
All right.
We want that to happen.
Look, Emperor is nice with his.
Yeah.
Misan is triply nice with his, for real.
Yeah.
And I know some martial artists around the country that are really, really nice.
Yeah.
And so we'll see what I can pull together. If you want to be on Professor Griff's martial arts DV for children, for children.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Young people, not just
right.
Children.
You ain't got to come breaking bricks. Well, you might want to break a couple of bricks. That's cool.
I want to see you break a brick with your head.
With my
head. The mic. some of the aggravation that I felt for you sometimes, maybe that would like just flush it all out. To see your head go up against a brick.
For real?
Yes, sir.
See, if I do it, then what you want to do?
Nothing.
Because it's not like it haven't been done before.
Thank you.
That's whack. Anyway. For all those people that have been very supportive and understand what we have to go through
mm-hmm.
to step to this microphone every Tuesday and Thursday and to step up to the plate Wednesday night with Brother Rich.
And it's not just that. Like, we live this.
Yeah, people don't understand that.
From the time we wake up in the morning to the time we go to sleep at night, we are literally studying or writing or coming up. I mean, this man right here has so many different concepts and ideas that he wants to put together to build this brand of NMEMINDZ Radio as well as use it as a tool to uplift and edify our people. And a lot of that momentum is coming from the testimonies that we are getting from our people and the impact that we are having all around the world.
Right. We don't want people to think that the haters are the ones fueling this. We don't thrive off of that energy.
No.
It's the positive people that call and leave the messages and the text messages. And
yeah.
Now. No.
Now. Testing. Everything is plugged in.
Hold up. I know a way
to find out. Okay, Monique says she can hear us.
Hold on. I know a way to figure it out.
Okay. Now they can hear us. All right, cool. So what were we saying? What were you saying?
Oh, we were talking about you said basically normally people that the ones that are
Who always talk about haters are the biggest haters themselves.
Right, exactly. So yeah.
So is that your shout out? I don't want to interrupt.
I have one last shout out, but I have to find a flyer, so you go and do that.
All right, shout out to Brother T. Cole, who is always supporting NMEMINDZ Radio. Good looking out, King. Shout out to Brother Mark in the UK. Good looking out, big homie. Shout out to Brother Amaru in Japan. Shout out to Brother Gregory, who is from the UK. He's in Thailand now. Shout out to Sister Sharon in the UK. Shout out to Yusuf, who I believe is in Haiti. I emailed him earlier because he got the book and he told me the cover was tight and everything. And I'm like, okay, I had to make some clerical, I had to change some things. I've basically gone back through and had to edit the book again. And some of the typing, the font on the front page is not what I want it to be. It will be in the revision, which I'm waiting for the new shipment to come in. But yeah, that is what it is.
The people that got this version, though, that's a collector's item.
Yeah. And he sent me a really powerful and positive response. He said, Elijah Muhammad taught us to study the white man. And he said, if you study them and how they built their world, they never strive to be perfect the first time out, because if you do, you'll never get it out.
Mm.
That's why you always have a second edition, a third edition, et cetera, et cetera.
Does the Griff say that? familiar. Okay, go ahead.
I'm going to punch you in the head.
I said that to you while I tried
you
to
did
tell you.
Say that. You said it in a different way, but you did say it. Yes, okay. You did. You've been saying, but you know, when you're in the thick of it, you know,
right.
It's hard to see the forest from the trees.
Right.
So shout out to Brother Yusuf. Shout out to Sister Michaela out in Jamaica. One love, sis. I appreciate you, and you inspire me just as much as I inspire you. Shout out to Jason Lord in the UK. Peace, King. And there's somebody in the chat room that is coming in from the UK. He said he's from the UK, so down in the boondocks. Peace, King. We love and appreciate you as well as all of our listeners all around the world. I'm going to try to get all of their names so every now and then I can just kind of shout them out to make sure we let them know that we love them and we appreciate their energy from wherever they are.
Who was that sent you a message and shout them out?
Who sent me a message and said shout? Somebody. Oh, I got to find it. Somebody sent me a message and said, can you please shout me out, Ray?
Right.
I got to find that.
Shout out to Dale and Eddie, man. DJ, man. We're going to make sure this thing happen, man. All right. But anyway, shout out to Victory. Miss Victory. Miss Salazar. Y'all can go to www.victorysalazar.com. Her phone number is 703-521-3366. Well, I'm giving you a phone number and an email address, website, all that kind of stuff, simply because she's bringing Professor Griff to speak live and direct to you in Fredericksburg at Central Station, 917 Prince Anne Street in Fredericksburg, VA. That's Thursday, June 18th, 2015. Part of the Rising Legends event. Alright, so shout out to Vanessa. Alright, listen, I need all y'all hip-hop heads, poets, musicians, if you're thinking about being in the music industry or you got some funny questions you'd like to ask pertaining to hip-hop, rap, music industry, entertainment industry, I'm going to cover pretty much a few subjects that night, so I need y'all to be in the building. It's going to be a very unique couple of hours, so I need y'all to be there front row. All right, hit Vanessa up at 703-520-3366.
And, of course, we are going to be in Dallas, Texas on June 28th. Flyer is on Facebook. Hopefully, Kenita has put it on the Twitter page. If not, I know she is going to. Chris Monroe hit me up and said, we are big fans of yours. When is your birthday? November 5th is my born day, as the big homie would say. Yeah, I just wanted to get that out there. I don't know why. No, Dallas. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Dallas.
I'm looking for that message. But Dallas, June 28th. And then the brother's working on North Carolina. John Trey.
No, it's going to happen. It's going to happen.
I'm promoting it.
Huh?
I'm talking about promoting it.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. Let's make it happen. All right, so the subject for tonight, gentrification. Tonight on NMEMINDZ Radio, gentrification and its role in displacing our community. What happened to our people after Hurricane Katrina is a question that's often asked. Was that gentrification? Even if it was a natural disaster, the question that Spike Lee asked, and we should all be asking, where are the people?
Yeah.
Where are the people? Also, can Brooklyn, Oakland, Detroit, and any major black city be gentrified? If we don't own anything, if you don't own it, how could you say you've been misplaced and it's not your place?
That's what I asked in Brooklyn. I said, how many people that you know have been displaced? Actually,
right.
Go ahead.
What steps can we take towards stopping the bleeding and breakdown of black communities and build strong black-owned infrastructure? The call-in number is 347-633-9644. This is Professor Griff and Ms. ZaZa Ali, and we are officially on NMEMINDZ Radio.
And the DVD sale is officially on. You want
to...
It's on. You want to get the list real quick?
Yes, boss.
Real quick. I'm just asking. Thank you, sir. Yeah, so you can give you a five and I can give you a five. What we did this month is we split the list in half. All the DVDs we selected are new. But we split the DVD in half. He came up with his 30-some-odd. I came up with my 30-some-odd. And then we also have an ebook. Anybody who places an order this month is going to get a free mixtape CD of myself, Francis Cresswell-Singh, and Marimba Ani that Griff put together.
For the Divine Goddess Principle.
For the Divine Goddess Principle. It's a mixtape, so you will get some hip-hop, not hip-hop, music in the background.
No, there's some hip-hop.
Some hip-hop,
there's some,
just beats in the background is what I wanted to say.
Yeah, but the music is by all women.
Yeah.
Okay. All women. Okay. All women speaking, all women that made the music. So, I don't even think I see yours. You might want to print out another one because I see mine. But my recommendation, of course, you know I had to have Khalid Abdul-Muhammad and Malcolm X.
Yeah.
All right. Just with this list, putting 30 together, I just said to myself, this is critical. My brothers and sisters from Haiti, very special place in history,
mm-hmm.
and Haiti should have a very special place in all of our hearts.
That's right.
They whipped the hell out of this cracker for real and demonstrated and showed that it can be done. So the Haitian Revolution.
And they've been playing ever since.
Yeah. All right. Dick Gregory, my man, in rare form. You know I had to choose Dick Gregory. So it's Dick Gregory, Khalid Abdul-Muhammad, Malcolm X, Baina, which is the Haitian Revolution. Hold up. What's my other one? Oh, my last one is, you know I had to choose this one, Special Agent Self-Defense Kill Moves. Just straight up go for the jugular vein. Pow. Out of here. We'll talk to y'all some other time. The funeral will be next week, Thursday, 6 o'clock.
Mm.
You understand what I'm saying? Special Agent Kill Moves. Self-Defense Kill Moves. Those are my five. Okay, you need music behind yours so you can...
I don't, but now, yeah. You know, now it's when the real stuff starts. No disrespect. Okay. First of all, the sale dates are June 2nd to June 9th. My first one is Haiti, Earthquake, and Harp, Weather as a Weapon, because, they're doing some major things, and hopefully everybody has listened to our interview, our recent interview with Brother Rich, where we talked about chemtrails and, you know, using weather as a weapon. It's also what I talk about in the book, first book, The Scientific Intervention in Our Affairs. My second choice was Outfoxed, Rupert Murdoch's War on Journalism.
Wow.
You should definitely know who Rupert Murdoch is.
Right, exactly.
If you're serious about knowing about what's going on in this day and time and how they are using media to manipulate the minds of everybody on this planet,
mm-hmm.
you definitely want to look into Rupert Murdoch. My third one is Khalid Muhammad, Gathering of the Metaphysical Masters, because it's Khalid Muhammad. Amy Wellington, Geoengineering, Climate Warfare, and the Collapse of Civilization. Now, listen, I know everybody is not going to be as into this type of study that as I am, but it's fascinating to me.
But nowadays you have to, because you have to become well-rounded. Some childish idiot may say, oh, this DVD thing don't compare to something. That is foolish.
Yeah.
And childish.
Yeah. So anyway, Dane Wigginton, he's definitely one of the people that I study a lot. And then Professor Griff, the triple alphabet theory, the conspiracy of the Matrix.
Mm-hmm.
Can you real quick just give the people a brief synopsis of what you mean by the triple alphabet theory?
Well, when we talk about the triple alphabets, let's look at everything that we see every single day with three letters. Can mm-hmm. you name some?
NBA, TNT,
mm-hmm.
IMF, CIA, CNN, IRS.
Right. You're one of them rare individuals with your government name. You have four initials, but we're not going to talk about that. Anyway, this triple alphabet theory.
Oh, yeah. Everything, see, I'm from the birth. That's what I'm saying.
Everything that deals with the triple alphabet, let's start connecting the dots. What does the FBI and CIA got to do with the IMF, the IRS, and the International Monetary Fund?
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? So mm-hmm. if we look into the whole idea of just the number three that surrounds us, everybody's listening to the sound of my voice.
Mm-hmm.
If you are a Christian and you have a Christian name, then you have three names.
Right.
First, middle, and last. When the police pull you over and take you downtown, what do they give you? The third degree. Do you understand what I'm saying? So even when coming up as a child, and those stories that they used to read to you, the candy bar you eat is the Three Musketeers, the story that was read to you, the Three Little Pigs, the Three Blind Mice, and the Three Square Meals a Day, and we could go on and on and on about the triple alphabet theory.
Yeah.
Well, I tied all of that into the matrix, decoded it, and put it in a language that you could understand on my DVD, The Triple Alphabet Theory. And I did that at the House of Consciousness in Norfolk, Virginia. Shout out to Drea.
Yep.
All right.
Always.
And Olmec. All right.
All right, and if you don't want to get in on the DVD sale, if your money is funny or whatever, and you ever want to order any of the DVDs that you hear us talking about outside of the sale, they're going to be $10 a piece, but you can still have access to them. Just shoot me an email at mindzmatterbtrs. I forgot to give the email address. MINDZMATTERBTRS@gmail.com.
All right, also available a little bit later on, probably in a week and a half or so. We're going to have to... let the people know that the Divine Goddess principle is being DVD. Put together. They're kind of taking their time because they said it's a lot of footage.
Yeah, it is.
Whatever, whatever, whatever. So,
and a lot of people have been hitting me up about it.
Right.
We should have it in 2 weeks, right?
Get it right, less than that. Get it right, bub. So they're going to get it right. Trust me. But check this out. These e-books.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of brothers, they said they was going to be listening today. They hit me up. They said, listen, man, we started our research and our studying, man, but we can't afford all these books.
Right.
So we track down some stuff and we put it on CD-ROM for you. And Zaza says best. I had, 100 on there?
You had, it was over 100, yeah.
No, we had to break it down.
We had to split it into three.
It's just, it's overload.
Yeah.
So.
And you know what? I told you, like, people will see that and it'd be like, oh my God, it's 100 books. And then they'll never read any of them.
Right. So we broke it down to 45 books.
Yes.
For $20.
Yes.
To us, $1 a book, $2 a book.
That's like 50 cents a book.
Okay.
That's less than 50 cents a book.
Less than 50 cents a book.
Mm-hmm.
One of the ones that got your attention was Bruce Lee's training manual.
Bruce Lee's training manual. Yeah. And it's like you know how people, you know, make copies of books and then, you know, you get a copy of a copy of a copy and it's raggedy and square. No, all of these books are like legit.
Right. So you can go find this stuff at the Book Nook.
Yeah.
But so, that's a lot of searching.
It is.
It's, yeah.
So the Bruce Lee's manual, there's images of him
doing
the moves that he's talking about.
Right.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So, Behold the Pale Horse, Tavistock Institute, None Dare Call a Conspiracy, Secret Societies, Hidden Persuaders, and all kind of books.
The Hidden Persuaders, the Tavistock Institute, like, seriously.
Just alone.
Those two books alone.
Right. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, hit us up. Send an email to ZazaMindsMatterBTRS@gmail.com. Someone sent me a message, Zaza, from the 202 area code,
mm-hmm.
and they said a report came out in May that states that 1 million black men are unaccounted for in America.
Mm.
1 million.
What?
They are incarcerated. They are not dead. They are not working. They have simply vanished. He said,
bro, where is that?
Google it. Also, check out Dr. Umar Abdullah Johnson's talk entitled Dr. Umar Johnson in Atlanta on 5/16/2015 at 1 minute 14 seconds, 14 minutes and 52 seconds. On this vid, he speaks out about this particular thing.
Okay, I see the New York Times. It says 1.5 million missing black men.
Mm. Just missing.
Damn.
So when we talk about gentrification, we not only talk about changing the infrastructure and change the physical infrastructure and changing how the place looks, they also change how it works.
Mm.
And they also change the demographic of the people that presently live in these particular areas. Tonight's discussion here on NMEMINDZ Radio, we're talking about gentrification. Has your neighborhood changed? Did they give you a voucher to move you out on the outskirts of town while whites come back in now and take over the inner cities? Do you know some whites that are called the hipsters? Do you know anyone participating in the hipsterification of black communities? Do they hide it under the guise of redevelopment and social gentrification? All right. Social cleansing, some people call it. Progressive gentrification, wanting the place to look better, but yet they raise the prices so high,
mm-hmm.
and then they'll make lofts and expensive restaurants and this kind of thing, put in the area and just move you totally out simply because you cannot afford it, or they won't renew your lease. Your grandmama's grandmama been living there all her damn life.
Yeah.
And you've been there, but now you find yourself having to live somewhere, especially here in Atlanta. All of the homes have been taken back. Carver Homes, Grady Homes, Capital Homes, Herndon Homes, Bowen Homes, all of the homes, they're running the people out. And they're sending them way down south somewhere, way out past Stone Mountain somewhere. And and people are just giving vouchers to move out, never to come back.
That's crazy.
Gentrification. It's going on in the ATL.
Gentrification is a general term for the arrival of wealthier people in an existing urban district, a related increase in rents and property values, and changes in the district's character and culture. The term is often used negatively, suggesting the displacement of poor communities by rich outsiders, but the effects of gentrification are complex and contradictory, and its impact varies. Many aspects of the gentrification process are desirable. Who wouldn't want to see reduced crime, new investment in buildings and infrastructure, and increased economic activity in their neighborhoods? Unfortunately, the benefits of these changes are often enjoyed disproportionately by the new arrivals, while the established residents find themselves economically and socially marginalized. Gentrification has been the cause of painful conflict in many cities, often along racial and economic fault lines. Neighborhood change is often viewed as a miscarriage of social justice in which wealthy, usually white, newcomers are congratulated for improving a neighborhood whose poor minority residents are displaced by skyrocketing rents and economic change. Although there is not a clear-cut technical definition of gentrification, it is characterized by several changes. You have this up, right? You want to read demographics?
No, I don't. I have something else.
Okay. Demographics, an increase in median income, a decline in the proportion of racial minorities, and a reduction in household size as low-income families are replaced by young singles and couples. Real estate markets. This is key right here, family. Real estate markets, large increases in rents and home prices, increases in the number of evictions, conversion of rental units to ownership, that's condos, and new development of luxury housing. Land use, a decline in industrial uses, an increase in office or multimedia uses, the development of live-work lofts and high-end housing, retail, and restaurants. And then lastly, culture and character. New ideas about what is desirable and attractive, including standards, either informal or legal, for architecture, landscaping, public behavior, noise, and nuisance.
If you are the kind of individual that grew up, especially in the South, and your bloodline traces back to the continent, then we're used to grass, trees, and a few other things. Some of these places that I go into that are regentrified, so to speak, no trees.
Yeah.
No trees, nothing growing. So some people are just taking plots of land that's been abandoned and growing fruit and vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
But it will be on the side of the highway some damn way, which is toxic.
Yeah.
So we have to understand this particular dynamic that's going on. Gentrification, the buying and renovation of houses and stores in deteriorated urban neighborhoods. My question is, can a white neighborhood be gentrified? We're going to talk about that and a lot more when we come back as we open up the phone lines a little bit later on to hear what you have to say here on NMEMINDZ Radio. The subject matter is gentrification. This is Professor Griff ZaZa, and we will be right back. The call-in number is 347-633-9644. We'll be right back.
All Them DVDs has got you covered for your DVD needs. History, Pan-Africanism, religion, metaphysics, health, astrology, economics, and more. AllThemDVDs.com has over 7,000 titles. If we don't have it, we'll get it. Go to AllThemDVDs.com now for discounts. That's AllDemDVDs.com or call 267-257-3270. Yes, All Them DVDs. Remember, AllThemDVDs.com.
Get your loved one out of jail. Express Bail Bonding Company is located at 236 Forsyth Street, Southwest Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. We provide professional and courteous service with getting your loved ones out of jail fast. We are open 24 hours a day and provide service in the surrounding Georgia counties and the United States. Call us at 404-522-3201. Again, that's 404-522-3201. Once again, that's 404-522-3201. Craftswoman Products and Services. Get your wholesale shea butter, waste beads, and custom candles. Go to candlescreated.com or call 214-659-1RBG. Order your Ankh and Pyramid candles. Choose color and fragrance. Candle making class is also available. Go to candlescreated.com or call 214-659-1RBG.
Now, wait a minute. That was about making candles. I need to take that class. Can I play that commercial again? I gotta hear that again. Maybe I heard something wrong, because if I could make a candle that, you know what kind of candle I'd like to make? Oh, I'm sorry. Hold on one second.
Thank you.
What'd you say?
She
wants to build a candle pyramid, she said.
She said she has a candles pyramid.
Wait a minute. Let's go back. Let's hear it again. Hold on.
I'm going to
No. Craftswoman Products and Services. Get your wholesale shea butter, waste beads, and custom candles. Go to candlescreated.com or call 214-659-1RBG. Order your Ankh and Pyramid candles. Choose color and fragrance. Candle making class is also available. Go to candlescreated.com or call 214-659-1RBG.
All right, I heard it right. I want me a red, black, and green candle. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you what. I'm going to put the candle I want on our Facebook page. Is that cool?
Yeah.
So if that sister can go to the Facebook page.
I'm sure she's listening.
Well, I hope she is, because I'm going to put it on NMEMINDZ Radio on Facebook, the candle that I want. And matter of fact, when I get that candle from her, I want a pillow from these people.
Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud. Wear your pride on your chest with Foxy's unique limited edition apparel for men, women, and kids. Check them out at myfoxy.com. That's MYFOCSI.com. At Foxy, they even have a variety of art, pillows, and more at myfoxy.com. Use coupon code MMBTRS14 and get 10% off your order. Get Foxy.
This sister, craftswoman, I'm looking at her website. She says she does consulting and personal services, candle making classes, holistic doula, prenatal, birth, and postpartum, manicures and pedicures, spa parties, womb wellness for sisters against fibroids.
Oh, wow.
Sisters against fibroids. Womb yoga and yoni steaming. I've done yoni steaming before. Definitely recommend that. Licensed life insurance agent, wholesale products, and handmade waist beads. She got to be from Jamaica.
She could just be from Africa, or she just could be.
You know
black.
How they said Jamaicans have, you know,
59 jobs.
Yeah. Go to the sister's website. Check her out. She's one of our new sponsors, and we definitely want to support her. So we're going to support her, and we definitely want the family to support her as well, especially sisters who may be pregnant or suffering with different health ailments. Shout out to the crafts woman.
All right. All right. So let me bring Shade down. So gentrification, the question I asked before we went for the break was, can white neighborhoods be gentrified? Now, what is the difference between gentrification and regentrification?
What is the difference between gentrification and regentrification? I'm going to say that regentrification happens all over again. Oakland, for example.
Right.
West Oakland. At one point, Oakland was a predominantly black city and a very progressive, predominantly black city. It has the second largest port in the country. And, of course, you know what that means, money. And then, of course, it's right, you know, the city next to San Francisco. So it was always a city that had, you know, middle class, upper class blacks, as well as other people who were, you know, doing well. West Oakland, which was the hub for the Black Panthers, was a very, you know, they had the projects in West Oakland. They had a project in East Oakland, too. But in West Oakland, the projects were there. You know, it was predominantly poor, the hood, you know, the murder dubs and all these different, you know, highly, what's the word I'm looking for? High rates of crime, high rates of homicide. So, you know, we saw Oakland go through a gentrification period where the government, you know, the mayor and whatnot went from being black to being mostly white, right? So there was a period of gentrification where the city as a whole was being gentrified. All of the power positions were being taken over, and different parts of the city were kind of being taken over, and, you know, the yuppies, the real estate yuppies, as well as the tech yuppies. Now, West Oakland, this is the re-gentrification, because at one time they wouldn't touch West Oakland. It was just too grimy. It was too black. It was too poor.
Right.
Now,
too black, too
those
strong.
Victorian homes in those areas that were run down and beat up look so beautiful, look so clean, so sparkly, so new. They've turned the whole landscape into something really, really beautiful to the eye. And the people who are natives there, people who spent their whole lives in West Oakland, can't even afford to live there anymore. And it's like, even if you don't mortgage your house to, you know, to the end of the world, you know, some people keep taking mortgages and they own some people who live there, even if they didn't do that, the property taxes get so high because new people come in and buy new property. Now your house was at once worth $200,000. Everybody around you's house is worth $600,000-$700,000. You're paying property taxes based on what those homes are worth.
Wow.
A lot of people get ostracized like that. And then they end up having to take a mortgage out to be able to survive.
Right.
Now, you know, you get behind. The next thing you know, you're losing your house.
Wow.
So we cannot neglect the impact that the banking and the financing industry, mortgage industry has. In gentrification.
That was one of my questions I was going to ask you, since you're more knowledgeable about that particular field. Who benefits and who loses?
Well, the banks always win. The banks always win because, number one, whatever they lose, quote unquote lose, they're writing it off at the end of the year as bad debt.
Okay.
And if you're working with a, you know, $10 billion, you know, budget per year, if you have to write off a $600,000 house mortgage, I should say, that's just as beneficial as having the $600,000 actually paid to you.
Let me ask you some quick questions, and you let me know, win or lose. The schools.
For black people? For our people?
Gentrification. The schools. Who wins? Who loses?
Our people lose. Anyone who is being put out loses.
Right.
The ones who come in who are raising the property taxes, where that money is actually going to go into building those schools, up, they win. The people who come in and who restructure and who rebuild those areas, their children will win eventually, but it doesn't happen immediately. It takes time.
But does the school get better? Is the school better?
The schools get better if the people put their children in them. If those people who are coming in put their children in those schools, they will get better.
Church. Black neighborhood, been black all this time. Reverend Pigfoot ain't moving his church.
Right.
Reverend Hamhock ain't moving his church.
Right.
So who wins? Who loses?
If the parishioners stay, the church is always
going to win. The parishioners have been moved out, though.
Huh?
The parishioners have been moved out.
Right,
remember?
But we got people that have moved from Oakland to Stockton and Tracy who still drive back an hour on Sundays to go see their pastor.
That's why
their
I asked, who wins?
They are loyal. Christians are loyal to their churches. But then you got to remember, too, a lot of these churches now, and I know some in Oakland, have taken not a 501c3. Is it a
501c3? Yeah,
501c3, where they are actually getting money from the government and are able to keep their doors open. And it's fueling a whole new, quote-unquote, economy of churches, if you will, to where they're able to keep their doors open. I had a brother who I had a lot of respect for tell me, look, I had this white dude come in and tell me that he would do this, and this. My people ain't giving money. The doors run down. The building is run down. We can't get new carpet, you know, whatever. He wrote me a check for $10,000 the same day. I'm like, bruh, what? He just flew in on a red carpet?
Right.
So they have people who are scouting black churches in urban neighborhoods, gentrified neighborhoods, that want to keep their doors open because they need the churches to stay open.
Right.
They are paying them to stay open as long as they push the agenda. Don't talk about homosexuality, right?
Right. Of course they're going to set the guideline.
Don't go against the grain.
Don't have
Barack
a black
Obama,
Jesus. Don't have a
Hillary
black Jesus.
Clinton.
Gotta have a white Jesus.
Whoever the Democrat is.
Right.
keep the white Jesus.
White angels.
Okay. We'll give you a little bit of money to loan to the parishioners.
Right.
You know, that type of thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. I dealt with the church. We dealt with the school. When I'm thinking gentrification, I'm thinking of all the things that we as black people know to be in black neighbors. We know the dude that sells the bootleg liquor in the cut. We know he got to go.
Right.
The dude that sells the weed around the corner at the red door, knock three times, wait on the, we know he got to go. I'm just talking about staple marks.
Yeah, like
Madea,
beauty salons.
Hair salon that's been there forever.
They definitely lose. They get impacted. Now, you know, Oakland is the type of city where if you have, you know, black people are still there. They're still there.
Right.
But, you know, you got to be making money and doing something for yourself to be able to survive in that type of environment.
Right.
I mean, you can't get a one-bedroom apartment for anything less than $1,000.
Okay, but if, you are, if you've been there and all you've been eating is fried food, some young boy from the local Chinese dude that's cooking that nasty food that you've been eating, Popeyes and Kentucky Fried Chicken and Murder King and these places have been set. These little holes in the world that black people eat this fast food to death.
Yeah.
Okay, do they win or do they lose? Because now these fancy restaurants are coming in serving tofu a la carte type shit, and black people don't eat this stuff.
No, you understand those, what I'm saying? Kind of restaurants, they usually are able to stay afloat. But, you know, it depends on a lot of things. Yuppie white people eat trashy food, too. They
do. But black people are not going to a place and spending $5 for a frappuccino or a latte.
Right, true that.
So who loses? Who wins? Who?
I mean, you know, it depends on the business's ability to be able to kind of switch with the times. If you're a business that's barely making ends meet and then gentrification hits, yeah, it's a wrap.
Okay.
You know, I know beauticians that their business slowed down. They weren't making as much money, but they're still doing their thing. They're still doors are still open, but they had to switch gears.
Okay,
they probably have to charge their clients a little bit more, which means they're going to lose some people. But you got to switch gears and do what you got to do.
Yeah, but if you own a restaurant, this is the last point I'm going to make on it. If you own a restaurant and you've been making damn fried bologna sandwiches and eggs, on wheat toast with mayonnaise, on white toast with mayonnaise, now that the gentrification happened, you've got white college students. What's the restaurant we stopped at a couple of times? Woodlands in D.C. On George Adams.
Woodlands?
Everlasting Life?
It used to be Everlasting
Life. It's Woodlands now.
Yeah.
That place has totally changed.
Totally different. Same, well, I never saw it before, but.
Same food, but all white people now.
Yeah.
So do you change your menu? You change the pictures on the wall? You take down the African masks? Mm-hmm. What do you do?
Yeah. That's what they did.
So we lose.
I mean, you know.
They come in and we lose aspects of our culture.
You lose the culture. I mean, it's like you look at it this way. Everybody in there is black, right? Everybody working in there is black, right?
Mainly.
So, I mean, we got to give them props for doing that, you know, because a lot of our people say, well, I got to, you know, get a little bubbly white girl at the counter, you know, in order to attract other people.
Right.
That place is staffed all black. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Now, are there any African masks and any, you know, notable historical figures on the wall? No. It's like regular, you know, Art Deco situation in there to attract everybody and make everybody feel welcome, I'm assuming.
Mm-hmm.
But the staff is all black.
Right.
So, you know, it's kind of balanced out.
Oh, I was just wondering because I'm reading about gentrification and I'm saying, fine that the place is looking better.
Mm-hmm.
Streets are cleaner. The firemen actually come when you call them.
Yeah.
The police come when you call them. And Tay Tay, Man Man, and Twan and them are not on the corner no more because that's hustling backwards.
Mm-hmm.
It's looking better, but does it feel better?
Yeah. No, I would say no. That's one of the reasons why I left Oakland. The soul is gone.
Yeah, it's gone.
The soul is gone. And so as we've traveled to all these different cities, we've heard the same thing.
Right. Over
Baltimore, and over. Washington, D.C., Oakland, Detroit, New Orleans, a lot of the cities and the areas that were predominantly black have been slowly but surely moved out. So this is a question that I have for you as well as the listeners, because I was reading something on one of these articles that I was writing that I read. Do you have an issue living in the hood or living around your people? And I'm going to tell you why I said this. I got in contact with a sister Erica, who was from Oakland. She mm-hmm. moved to Dallas. She was telling me about her, you know, where she lives and everything. She said, I'm in the hood, but I love the hood, you know. And she just was telling me about, you know, her experience there and how, right. you know, she has so much land and she's able to cultivate the land and whatnot, things that she would never be able to do in a city like Oakland.
Right.
So how do you feel about living in the quote-unquote hood? Because if we're talking about turning the tide of gentrification, we have to have long-term vision, right?
Mm-hmm.
We have to be able to see past what we see right now and have long-term vision in order to go into those abandoned homes, go into those abandoned businesses,
right.
and be able to rebuild them. Let me say this real quick. Mm-hmm. Steve Bradley said, folks need to reclaim all these abandoned towns across the country. They have a lot of infrastructure going to rot, and the property is cheap. And, yeah, let them have the cities. The cities are designed to drain you.
Yeah, they are.
Great point, Steve. Great
right.
point.
But when you really truly look at it, mm-hmm. the hoods are in the city the way they designed it, because they, white people,
mm-hmm.
wanted to move away from black people.
Right.
To the suburbs with lawns and
yeah.
they would take walks and
mm-hmm.
walk scruffy and, you know, that other thing they sleep with. But I'm just saying.
Mm-hmm.
But
think about this. Think, and this is genius, whether it was planned or not planned. When I was doing the research on Pruitt-Igoe
mm-hmm.
in St. Louis, right?
Okay.
Now, this is exactly what you're talking about. The hood, smack dab in the middle of the city, in this very urban development area where
right.
they got the stadium and all of that type of stuff, right? They moved to the suburbs. They put 10,000 black people in a hell hole right in the middle of, you know, nobody wants this area, right?
Right.
20 years later, this is prime real estate,
right, like it is in every city.
Prime real estate.
Right.
East
now,
Oakland, right by
okay.
the Oakland Coliseum. The projects right there, even in West Oakland where the projects were, that's prime real estate right now.
Right, exactly.
So the question is, was there somebody sitting back and saying, okay, this is going to be like putting money in the bank and just letting the interest grow? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I see exactly what you're saying.
Then you go in and give the people a voucher, like you said, and send them everywhere else.
Right, send them everywhere else.
I'm sorry. Go ahead and make your point.
Because those people didn't allow them to own.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
So every city is like that.
There was no ownership opportunities at
exactly,
all.
Exactly, exactly. So in mm-hmm. Atlanta right now, the new stadium is being built.
Mm-hmm.
Everything around that is black.
Mm-hmm.
Everything.
Mm.
So by design.
But what is it going to be in 5-10 years?
Well, my nephew owns property
yeah.
over there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's kind of sitting on it to say they're going to have to offer me something astronomical.
But somebody will offer him something astronomical. That's the thing. We have a price, right?
You think he should just hold on to it?
No. I'm not saying that's – I wouldn't even try to, you know, his own situation.
Mm-hmm.
That's – but I'm saying for us, especially as we see the neighborhood changing, it's like, okay, somebody comes in, you bought this property for $150,000. They're offering you seven now.
Seven bills?
$100,000 for a property that
Dude.
You might owe $100,000
on? Dude, I'm, yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
I see exactly what you say. So the whole idea, who else is involved is what I wanted
to ask
you.
Well, the other people in the area that have purchased and fixed up and changed all and, you
right.
know, made the area look good,
right.
they're increasing the property value.
Right, okay.
So our question for us is, if you want to stay there, can you maintain and hold out? You know, can you pay those higher property taxes?
Mm-hmm.
Can you deal with the white yuppies walking their dogs with their cappuccino?
Mm-hmm.
You know, can you maintain through all of that, or should we start going and setting up shop somewhere else?
Right. Someone called it the hipsterfication.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see a lot of gay people getting together, living all on the same block, flying their flag.
Yeah, I can't do that. But to you, can you live in the hood? What do you think about that? What do you think about our people going to those areas where nobody wants to be anymore? Like Gary, Indiana.
You see, I can live in the hood.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, I can't live in the hood in Gary, Indiana. I'm sorry. Hell nah.
Well, but
I can't live in Gary, Indiana.
Gary, Indiana is
hell
scary.
Nah. It's
scary
as hell.
But can you see the vision?
I see the vision for
can
someone
you
else.
See,
mm-hmm.
No, it don't even have to be for someone else. It
listen.
Be, listen, not living there, investing in it.
Okay, that's cool. Yeah,
yeah.
I could do that.
Okay.
And make it safe for somebody else that like being cold. I don't like being cold.
I don't either.
Thank you. So, yeah. But, yeah, I could invest in it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Sunshine, for you said This is due to eminent domain. What do you think about that?
Well, eminent domain is when you live on a property. Remember I was telling you about this, if the house is near something that the city owns or the city may eventually want to take control of, the city or the county,
right.
Eminent domain can force you to sell your house. If you're near a highway, that's why I would never buy a house that is like right on a highway or a tract of land that may eventually become a highway or become something the government wants
right.
to come over,
right.
take over. You remember you said the bail bond.
Yeah, of course. That's what they did.
The city took over their business, his family's
yes.
business.
Right.
Okay, that's eminent domain. But usually in large areas where they're like right here where we are in Decatur, there's not eminent domain isn't going to be an issue right here. Now, if you're closer to Highway 20 or if you're closer to a freeway or something that has something to do with, you know, a stadium or something being built, then that can be an issue for you. Eminent domain
right.
doesn't cause gentrification, but it can, you know, be it can have an effect.
Are politicians in the hip pocket of the builders, the investors?
Always. Of course, they go hand in hand.
So it trickles down.
Absolutely.
So they benefit them.
Yes.
All right, cool. You had a clip you said you wanted to play?
I have a couple of clips. I want to start off with New Orleans because I think New Orleans, you know, and that was one of the questions that I asked is what happened in New Orleans gentrification if what happened started off from a so-called natural disaster. And, of course, anyone who has studied what happened in New Orleans know that that was not a natural disaster per se. But we're going to play this clip, and we will be right back in a second. You are tuned into NMEMINDZ Radio with Professor Griff and ZaZa Ali. We will be right back.
Broken glass, boarded up windows, fresh paint, a drink on the stoop. Two portraits of the same city, New Orleans, 7 years after Hurricane Katrina. The storm brought its destruction to New Orleans August 29, 2005. Scrubbing out neighborhoods, disrupting life in a city famous for its easy living. Today, this is a city with neighborhoods like Treme.
Hi, that's my neighbor.
With residents like school teacher Jamie Trent, who moved here from New Jersey after Katrina.
People are still positive and people are happy and they're so excited about the city again, which was not the feeling that first summer. It was a rough place to live at first.
New Orleans is a city with neighborhoods like Iberville, where one of the last housing projects will soon come down, replaced with new homes.
If they tear it down and don't rebuild, I would hate that. But if they tear it down to make it better, I love it.
You can see the transformation, call it gentrification, wider, richer, younger, in the maps of this geographer from Tulane University.
The city has also been rediscovered by the rest of the world since Katrina. It's intrigued lots of educated, young, progressive professionals, and they've moved here in large numbers.
New Orleans is booming, with whites moving in, the black population shrinking from 68% to 60% of the city, a drop of almost 119,000 people. The change is steeper than the new paint in long-standing neighborhoods.
Some people worry that this will change the culture of the city, to which I respond, the culture of the city has always been changed.
For some longtime residents, fear. For others, hope.
We can't look from yesterday of what's going to happen the next day, so all we can do is look for the best.
7 years ago, a hurricane laid this city low. 7 years later...
When it first happened on the news, I was like, they're going to rebuild New Orleans? And now here I am being, hopefully, a huge part of the rebuilding, building a house, being part of the recovery school system. So that was me eating my words, and I'm happy I'm eating them.
With the laugh, hope comes to New Orleans. Lee Powell, The Associated Press.
She said it was a rough place
wow.
to live at first.
Mm.
She said, I'm trying to figure out what is it about. I had a client one time who was looking for a property. Cool sister, she's straight hood, you know. She told me, I don't want to live around black people. I want to find a place where there's no black people.
Wow.
Do we have, you know, where there is no vision, the people will perish?
No, black people are certain segments of us, a certain.
I think she meant she didn't want to live around niggas, excuse my language, but that's not what she said. She said no black people.
Is she black?
Yeah, she's black. And she's hood.
So she don't want to live
around
somebody
around people
like
her. Exactly. I pray to God she was listening. But that's basically what it was. So anyway, you know, they had the interview, the brother, he said, I hope they tear it down. I hope they don't tear it down, but if they tear it down, I hope they rebuild something nice. And that stood out to me because here we have a black man, an older black man who's probably been in this area his whole life, talking about what other people who are not from there are going to come to his community and do.
Not for him.
Not at all.
Right. We need to understand that.
No.
They're rebuilding the world without us in mind.
Yes, they are. They absolutely are. So listen to this, brothers and sisters. This is an article from the Courthouse News Service. Let's see. This is dated February 2nd, 2012. This is something I talk about in my book. It says the United States claims St. Bernard Parish used a blood relative ordinance to deny African Americans housing and keep them out of the parish after Hurricane Katrina. It says neighboring Orleans Parish was 29% white and 67% African American. As a result of the devastation of Hurricane Katrina, St. Bernard Parish and the surrounding communities lost and have yet to fully replace a significant percentage of their single and multifamily rental housing stock, the complaint states. On December 25th, I'm skipping through the article. So on November 25th, 2005, 2 months after Hurricane Katrina, the parish imposed a 12-month moratorium on reestablishment or development of any multifamily dwellings within parish approval. On March 7, 2006, the parish passed another moratorium, this time prohibiting the rental of single-family homes in St. Bernard Parish, allegedly to preserve the integrity of single-family neighborhoods until such time as the post-Katrina real estate market in the parish stabilizes. However, a council member who voted against the ordinance stated that it was passed to block the blacks from living in those areas. The parish's blood relative exception was designed to be a proxy for race in order to artificially fix the racial composition of renters in St. Bernard's Parish. Through the comprehensive revisions, the parish reduced the land available for development of multifamily housing as of right by 99%, leaving only 109 acres for such development. Now, what is this saying? This is saying, you asked what the politicians usually in the backs of the builders mm-hmm. and the contractors. Yes, they absolutely are.
Right.
And this basically confirms it. But on to see this systematically take place, mm-hmm. normally when cities and when states go through, you know, natural disasters and that type of turmoil, the government reaches out to assist those people. They set up programs
right.
for their benefit.
Right.
New Orleans systematically ostracized the people
right.
from being able to come back and live there.
According to the blood.
That's you have deep. To be a blood relative to rent in this area. And do you think the owners protested that? Hell no.
Right.
Because we know who the owners were.
Right. That's deep. On a lot of different levels.
A lot of levels.
I'm serious.
A lot of levels.
This is from Minister Paul Scott in a warning. Shots fired. He says, when Black Wall Street turns white. It was Joni Mitchell that said, don't it always seem to go that way that you don't know what you got until it's gone?
Mm-hmm.
And we take it for granted.
Yeah.
I'm going to go into the article, but I want to ask you a question just from the rip. Gang members who argue and fight over turf. And claim turf.
Mm-hmm.
How could you claim turf that's not yours?
Yeah.
So what do they do once the gentrification? All levels.
Yeah.
All aspects of the people. What do they do when gentrification happens?
A lot of them move somewhere in jail. Because they toughen up on crime. A lot of them end up in jail. They increase the surveillance in the communities.
Do they go somewhere else and bang or?
I mean, you ain't going to bang like you bang where you from.
So you can't bang in a nice neighborhood.
No, I'm saying you can't bang. Like if you're from Atlanta and you go to New York, you're not banging in New York the way you bang
in
Atlanta.
Oh, no, the banging.
It's not going down.
You got to change your banging skills.
Exactly. That's just like if you leave New York and you go to Dallas, you're not going to bang in Dallas the way you bang
right.
in New York.
It says there was a time when Durham, North Carolina was known as the Black Wall Street of the South. He says, however, today when I walk down the street of the former mecca of the black economic achievement, I see only the residue of what was once great. Well, Minister Paul Scott, that is in every city.
Yeah.
It says the black-owned businesses, which were once an inspiration for generations of African-Americans, have been replaced by white-owned shops selling iced lattes. See, that's what I said. That's what I said.
Brothers and sisters, you better start learning how to make lattes.
Or on the land.
Serious. We got to learn how to start planting.
But right now, there's a 21-year-old listening to us that inherited her grandmom's
mm-hmm.
old house that
yeah.
she lives in right now,
yeah.
or the brother lives in right now, and he plans on selling it.
Yeah.
Nah, bruh.
Yeah.
We have to find a way to maintain that.
Yeah.
Fix it up. You understand what I'm saying?
We were in...
Keep it in the family.
Decatur. Downtown Decatur, which is, you know, my perception of Decatur based on what I had heard was nothing like it is when I see certain aspects of
right.
Decatur. I mean, there's a black Decatur, and then there's a white Decatur.
Right.
But we were driving down... What street was that? Ponce de Leon?
Ponce, yeah.
And I was like, where is our, you know, nice shops, boutiques, you know, spas, restaurants, you know, people walking, there's music playing, the energy is high, you know, the weather is nice. I'm like, where's our area like this?
Right.
I'm not talking about like, you know, yuppie black, you know what I'm saying, bougie, you know, people looking at you trying to figure out what kind of shoes and what kind of purse you're wearing.
Right.
I'm not talking about that type of environment. I'm talking about down home, cultural, you know, you may walk into a coffee shop and see Elijah Muhammad, see Marcus Garvey,
right.
see Sojourner Truth on the wall.
A red, black, and green flag every now and then.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The sister across the street with the spa who has her herbal thing that she does.
Right.
She does pedicures and manicures. You know, the office building that has the sister who does the
legal stuff.
The legal stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like everything that we need in our civilizations, why can't
right.
we build areas like that? And
right.
then you go to, what's the area, just because you know Atlanta, of Atlanta on the outskirts or whatever, that's like grimy right now, that like you go to and it's like you holding your bag?
Pittsburgh.
It's in Atlanta?
Yes.
Okay.
Right smack dab in the hood, not far from anything.
Okay.
From near downtown, Pittsburgh.
Okay. Why can't we go to Pittsburgh while the property value is cheap, while the buildings are dilapidated? Why can't we go to Pittsburgh, have some brothers, some militant brothers like yourself,
mm-hmm.
step to the youngsters, the dope boys, whatever, step to them, get the security thing tight, and start revitalizing those type of communities?
Right, exactly, and get some black developers to come in. Because
black
right
contractors,
next to, right,
black electricians, plumbers.
Right next to Pittsburgh is Mechanicsville. And anybody within the sound of my voice, no, that know the ATL, you know how Mechanicsville was.
Mm-hmm.
Now you go through there, like certain parts of Brooklyn that I know.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, when you start to see the white woman jogging them little skimpy little shorts, walking her dog,
mm-hmm.
it's a wrap. It's a wrap.
So let me ask you this, because they're in the chat room, and this is a great point, talking about you know, the fact that you never really own your property.
Yeah.
And we've had this conversation before.
Right.
Be it property taxes, be it eminent domain, be it clauses in the deed of trust, be it executive orders, like Mr. James said. What do you say about that? Does that discourage, should that discourage people from owning a home or?
No, but the rules now have changed.
Mm-hmm.
Not like it was before.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
My mom and her sister took pride coming from West Virginia to Long Island, New York,
mm-hmm.
and being able to purchase a home.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't afraid to work two jobs and you know, sell dinners
right.
on Sunday and that kind of thing. So
right.
the work ethic is totally different with our people nowadays.
Yeah.
And the whole idea of buying a home and the whole idea of owning something, it's you know, we have to be able to take stock in ourselves and invest in ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? Of course, we probably have to lose the me, the I mentality,
mm-hmm.
and think like other people think.
Mm-hmm.
Join some of these organizations that have certain degree of power, where and influence, where you know people at the bank is more apt to give you the loan based on the fact that you have a good reputation or whatever whatever.
Right.
And we have to do those kind of things. And it's just that, you know, it's a lot of other things other than us not having money that causes us not to own and not to invest in ourselves and not help other people invest.
Well, here's something else to add to that. This is from the article I was reading from earlier. No one is more vulnerable to the effects of gentrification than renters. When prices go up, tenants are pushed out, whether through natural turnover, rent hikes, or evictions. When buildings are sold, buyers often evict the existing tenants to move in themselves, combine several units, or bring in new tenants at a higher rate. When residents own their homes, they are less vulnerable and may opt to cash them in and move elsewhere. Their options may be limited if there is a regional housing shortage, however, and cash does not always compensate for less tangible losses.
Right.
So when we have the conversation, well, you know, you never really own your home, so what's the point anyway? Well, there's one great example right there.
Right.
When you own your house, yes, you may have to deal with taxes. Yes, you may have to deal with government, but ain't nobody kicking you out.
Right. You have leverage.
No one is evicting you. And even if you decide to move, you should have equity. You should be able to turn a profit.
Mm-hmm.
You should be able to decide what you want to do, opposed to being a tenant and being evicted.
Right. There was a scam that was uncovered at an apartment complex where the maintenance people, along with the security people, were allowing the maintenance people and some other people, the maintenance friends, to break in people's apartments because you're not allowed to have an alarm.
Mm.
And when you do, it's right connected back to them. You can't put up burglar bars because you're renting.
Mm-hmm.
Some apartment complexes don't allow you to have dogs, and all these restrictions
leave
you open for a whole bunch of things.
Yeah.
And we have to, you know, we have to understand that. I mean,
well, and remember, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was asking you earlier about your other point about us controlling and having a downtown area that's different.
Mm-hmm.
Where's the black cultural, conscious, vegan food, nice band playing DJ after spot?
After hours.
After hours spot.
Yeah.
Where's that spot at?
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
I do.
Every time I go to D.C., I go to Bus Boy and Poet because it got that kind of vibe that we need in some of these cities.
Yeah, it does.
You understand what I'm saying?
It does.
Yeah.
To speak on something you said, you know, Joy DeGruy said something in one of her lectures I was watching that really just made bells and whistles go off in my head. She said, when we were coming up, you know, we could have family members from out of town or people who were on hard times come and stay with the family.
Right.
You know, we got extra room, we got space,
right.
Or we don't have a lot of space, but of course you can come and live with us. Now, with the whole leasing aspect of renting a home or renting a place, you can't even have a person come and stay with you over a certain amount of time without being kicked out or them charging you more rent.
Right. Wow.
And when she said that, I was like, damn, that's deep, because she was saying it as another way that they basically have built these divisions within our family.
Right, exactly.
Because most of us are renting.
Right. So if your grandmother gets sick,
mm-hmm.
and you have to now take care of your mother and your grandmother,
mm-hmm.
because, you know, rather than putting her in some home somewhere, you can't have your grandmother come stay with you?
You'd have to get her on. You have to get permission to put her on the lease.
Wow.
Yeah. But you know, most places have a term. No one can stay that's not on the lease outside
for more than 6 months.
No, it's like 60 days.
Damn.
In California, I don't know, about 6 months. No, like 60 days in Cali.
Well,
I don't know what it is out here.
Some of my relatives, you don't want Twan staying for 6 months any old damn way. What I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's cold right there.
Yeah. So that's something, you know, for us to think about.
All right, so we're going to open up the phone lines after these commercial breaks to hear what you have to say about this particular subject, gentrification. Has it happened to you? Is it going on where you live right now?
So, and are you doing anything to avoid it?
Right.
Are you building something in your community that our people can be proud of and the generations to come behind us will be able to stand on?
Right. This is Professor Griffin ZaZa here on NMEMINDZ Radio. Call the numbers 347-633-9644. If you want to ask a question, make a comment, hit the number one button. All right, we'll be right back.
At Eat, Drink, and Be Conscious, we have a world of products choosing organic ingredients first and 100% all natural superior ingredients second. Eat, Drink, and Be Conscious created 100% all-natural personal skincare line, the home of our aluminum-free 100% all-natural deodorant with bentonite clay, with or without probiotics for adults and children. Our silky smooth 100% pure shea butter-based skin souffle is great for your skin, especially dry skin, all made with fragrances or pure essential oils. All of our products contain no useless carrier oils, no parabens, no animal derivatives, just no nonsense skin food. It's good for you. We even have 100% all-natural fluoride-free toothpaste that remineralizes your teeth and helps prevent tooth decay. Visit edmbc.com. Order your superior products today. Health is wealth, and you're worth it. edmbc.com.
Does your business need a boost? Did you hire Pookie and them to do your logo? At Free Yourself Design, we can help you and your business stand out with our graphic design services, backed by our 100% custom design guarantee. Call us today, 919-964-FYD1. That's 919-964-3931. Or email us at freeyourselfdesigns@outlook.com. Free yourself and free your mind with Free Yourself Design.
Test of emergency alert system capabilities. This test message has been initiated by National
Alert. War is being waged against us on all levels. Be dressed, be ready with Warrior Wear t-shirts, long sleeve shirts, and hoodies. Come check us out at our website, warriorwearrbg.com. Again, that's warriorwearrbg.com.
Check 1, 2. This is Professor Griffin ZaZa Ali, and we are black here on Enemy Minds Radio. We're dealing with the subject of gentrification. And I know a few people that this has actually happened to that were given vouchers, and they just had to kind of just had to move. Had to get on up and get on out. All right. So if you're tired of being displaced, if you're tired of not understanding the whole idea of how your whole complexion of your neighborhood have changed, and you move away and you go somewhere and you come back to the old neighborhood. Like when I go back to Roosevelt, Long Island, it's a totally different place, man. Totally different.
Yeah,
very critical. So we're going to open up the phone line. As always, respect your hosts, and no long dissertations. And we're going to try to get as many people in as possible. Please do not be long-winded. Don't force my hand, brothers and sisters. Can y'all not do that? Thank y'all very much. I really appreciate y'all. Caller from the 760 area code. What's your name and where you calling from?
Hello?
Yes, how you doing?
Hello?
Peace.
I'm good. How you doing?
How are you, brother?
I'm great. I just have one question. This is a question, something to think about. When a young black person or any black person in general say, well, I can afford to move out the hood into the suburbs because I have children, and I want my children to get caught up in the street life. What would you say about people who think like that?
That's a good question.
Yeah, because I think like that.
Yeah.
So I don't have loyalty to the hood like that. I got loyalty to a quality of life.
Yeah.
But if I do happen to be in the hood and stay in the hood, I'm going to try to raise the quality of life of our brothers and sisters in the hood by doing the necessary work that I need to do in order to do that. I'm not moving out to the suburbs for the mere fact I have in mind that I'm going to abandon my people and abandon the hood. Even if I do move to the suburbs, I'm still going to the hood. I'm still going to get my hair cut at the barbershop and go and do what I need to do. You understand? I'll take my clothes to the cleaners.
Well, and I think, brother, first of all, that's a great question. I think that we have to mold the way our children see our people and see our communities. I was in a car with my son one time, and he was like 5 years old, and we drove past a liquor store, and he was like, look at that, Mom. It's a liquor store. It's people hanging out. We must be in a black neighborhood.
Wow.
So he understood already, based on what I had taught him about poverty, about, you know, poverty leading to crime and, you know, all the different layers of racism, white supremacy. So when you teach your child, you know, to look at your people with empathy and love and respect, but at the same time, give them game, give them street savvy, and then keep them, you know, under your arm and close by your side, and give them that cultural aspect, knowing who you are, you know, being around in positive environments where you see what a real black man looks like. If you're a young black man and you see a real, real, real black man, the chances of you following some clown on the block talking about giving you a dime sack to go sell some drugs are very small.
Right.
So I think it's the way we raise our children in the environments that mm-hmm. we have them in. What's going on in your household? Are you involved in their lives? Most children get involved in gangs and things like that because they are not getting the attention and the love that they need, or they need money.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah, anything to add, right, brother?
All right, brother. That's it. All right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Very, very, very good question. Caller from the 919 area code. What's your name? Where you calling
from? Yo, peace. It's B-Son. What's going on?
Peace, B-Son. What's good with you, man?
Can't call it. Congratulations, ZaZa, on your book.
Thank you, brother.
Not a problem. I think a lot of times that people are actually afraid and feel like they can't afford to move out the hood, or they don't want the responsibility of owning a home, and such as, you know, cutting the grass, you know, if something goes wrong with the equipment, you got to replace it, et cetera. And a lot of times down here in North Carolina, you know, as far as the hood part, the white folks are taking over, man, because the location is near downtown. So what they're doing, they're basically coming in the hood, raising the rent, rebuilding it, and then people can't afford to come back to the hood. So they start to go somewhere else, man. It's crazy.
Right, right. No, we understand exactly what you're saying, and we've met people like that, man. But what part of North Carolina, bro?
I'm in Raleigh, North Carolina, man.
Okay, going to try to get to Raleigh, man, and see what Raleigh looking like.
Yeah, I wanted to try to connect something together with Dr. Caban. We had discussed that, you know, on text message potentially at one time.
Okay, cool. Hit me up after the show, and we can make that happen, man.
All right.
All right? All right, cool. We'll talk about
peace.
It. That's B-Son. Stay up, B-Son. Peace. All right. Caller from the 404 area code. 404. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
Hey, what's going on, y'all? Peace. Can you hear me?
Yes. What's up?
Okay. I was listening. I was just thinking, whatever happened to some of the black banks that are in the black communities? Because the problem with not having a lot of black banks in the community, we have to go to the white banks, and the white banks in some cases are asking for 20% down. I'm trying to buy a $100,000 house. That means I got to put down $20,000.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying with that? I think that's part of it. And Griff, I know you're in Atlanta. I'm from the ATL. I was telling folks a long time they're gonna try to go after that AU center, that
yep.
Lion City, that AU center. And I
yep.
think Arthur Blank, that thug punk. I know they're gonna turn that. They're gonna turn one of them schools into a parking deck. Trust and believe that if nobody does nothing. But that's all I wanted.
All right, cool. Good point, man. Good point.
Well, I would say, brother, just knowing what I know about real estate, and, you know, nine times out of ten, the black banks are going to make you a certain percentage down as well, because even though the banks are black-owned, they're still run by the same guidelines as all of the banks.
Right.
And they have to – it depends on your credit. It depends on, you know, your work history and whatnot, but they don't want to take a high risk on anybody, no
right.
bank, black, white, otherwise. So, and I honestly recommend to people, when you buy a house, you should put at least 15% down, because walking into a house that at any moment could, the price value could drop, and then you end up owing more than what it's actually worth, and I've been in that situation before, is not a good look.
Right.
So at minimum 10% down, I recommend 15% down, but most banks, especially if you don't have good credit, black banks too, are still going to require
right.
that you put at least 20% down. Now, FHA loans,
mm-hmm.
you could probably still get a house for 3.5% down. There's a lot of different ways you can maneuver around that. I don't suggest buying a property with 3.5% down, but if you can get in and you know your money is going to be stable, I say do it and then double up on those mortgage payments.
Right.
But there are black banks across the country. I think there's, what, 21?
Yeah,
Citizens Trust Bank is the one in Atlanta.
Right.
As people say, well, that's the Black Boule. Well,
not only Black Boule, but I think they saw the white bank bought them out recently.
Okay. Yeah.
I hope Citizens Trust is not listening. I got $45 in the bank. Anyway, caller from the 908 area code. What's your name and where you calling from? They called me and I didn't respond. Caller from the 410 area code. What's your name and where you calling from? It's NMEMINDZ Radio.
Yeah, peace, King. Peace, Queen. This is caller from Baltimore. Yeah.
Peace.
Everything's good, man. I mean, you know, we maintain it down here, but what I wanted to say was I don't think there's a way to stop gentrification and how do you pronounce it?
Gentrification.
Simply because in Baltimore, we have Baltimore County, Baltimore City. When Baltimore City got bad, you know, when they dropped the drugs and the guns in Baltimore City, when that got bad, the image was for black people to move out into the county. So I was one of them families that, you know, my mother moved us out into the county. It did give us more opportunities. You know, it did let us see that there was something else in the world. But that's the image they paint. It's like a mental slavery. They paint that you need to get up out the hood type of thing when you really need to stay in the hood. Or if you're going to leave, then make sure you go back and build it back up. You know what I'm saying? So to me, it seems like it's a cycle that don't stop until, you know, we become more conscious. You know what I'm saying? Like, as far as money and my whole goal in life is really to get out of this country. Like, I wanna live even in Africa or on an island somewhere where money is not my God. Where if I write down 20 things that I do in a day, 19 of them I'm not doing it for money.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, but I know that's hard. You know what I mean? I know, you know, that would be hard because we were born here. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Some people say if you ain't making paper, you ain't making it. So, you know, so to live a life like that, it sounds like you'd be in heaven on one of them islands. How about you call an island right now and see if somebody's living like that already?
Right.
This is White Supremacy, local and global, man, but we really appreciate your perspective, all right?
Yeah, no problem, man. No problem.
All right. Find that island, that brother talking about.
And that whole idea of not having to live and move for money, man.
Right. I'm serious, man. We need to hook up with that brother, man. I'm going to be more to hook up with him. Caller from the 267 area code. It's Professor Griff and ZaZa Ali on NMEMINDZ Radio. What's your name and where you calling from?
Peace. Hi. Oh, my goodness. I got through. Peace, ZaZa.
Right.
I wrote you guys on NMEMINDZ on Facebook. It was a while back. I know you've been busy, and it was a long letter. But when you get a chance, please read it through and give your perspective on it.
What's your name? What's the letter? Who are you? Tell us something.
Oh, I'm sorry. Whitney Williams from Philadelphia.
Dude, Whitney, we so got you. I'm writing that down. Whitney Williams. All right.
What was the letter about, sis?
It was from a few shows back. It was about, you know what, you were commenting on Kendrick. It was when Kendrick Lamar announced that he was marrying his girlfriend, and the one girl, like, went off on him, calling him a coon and all this because his girlfriend was light-skinned.
Right.
Yeah, and I have responded to that because, I know now I'm going off topic, but just to make that short, but, like, I could see where she was coming from because I'm dark-skinned myself, but at the same time, it was just completely uncalled for. And it's one of those things where it's like where you see the whole light-skinned, they get all the play and all this, and they're considered beautiful. But I think she needed to come from a perspective where it's like, all right, you know, I'm beautiful in my dark skin, and you can be beautiful in your light skin too. It's not one is better than the other.
Oh, okay. So. All right. We'll read it. We got you.
I did want to comment on the gentrification, though, because I live in Philadelphia. And if you want to talk about a city that is changing, this is This is the city. And so I'm 28, and I've noticed even in just like the last 10 years since I've been in high school, this city is almost on a 360. Started, I would say, with like Fairmount. Now, again, that area was like drug ridden and this, that, the other, but that was the first one, and they cleaned it up. It's like, oh, okay, you know, fine. Then Center City, it's just getting farther and farther out. They've already got West Philly, and they changed the names of it. So West Philly is now University City, where and they're pushing the black people out. South Philly, they didn't get a name for that yet. North Philly is now Northern Liberties, where they're moving out all the black people, all the Latinos. And also something else I was thinking about is, and I don't know about the other cities, but our city has a black mayor. And I'm wondering if that's kind of like part of it, where they're going with cities that have black mayors so it doesn't come off as it being racist. You know what I mean?
Right.
Or like,
yeah,
like they're putting it on the
bait and switch, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Smoking.
And, yes. And another thing is, I don't know if you, but the Pope is coming to Philadelphia. I think it's at the end of this year.
Oh, wow.
And that's, yeah, that's when it really started. I think that's what, like, greenlit, or it was probably already greenlit, but that was, like, now everyone's accepting, like, oh, we're cleaning up the city because the Pope is
right.
coming this year. Like, no, you were doing that anyway.
Right,
and,
right. No problem. We just got about nine other callers waiting, but we get your point.
So
we really appreciate you.
We appreciate you, and that's great.
Right.
She made
Yeah, of course, but but because the Pope is coming, and everybody got to take out a broom, stop that.
Well, and
she said it was happening before they even thought the Pope was coming.
Renaming the
mm-hmm.
That's critical.
Yeah.
So you said renaming it, which is very, very key.
Mm-hmm. Meaning there are no more black people here. It's different now.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And now it's safe.
Thank you so much for your call, Queen.
Thank
before you.
You
take the next call, let me drop something on you real quick.
All right.
Detroit, this is an article on the Black Agenda Report. Detroit, the dispersal of urban black America begins. Two United Nations reporters have seen human rights violations around the world, but Detroit's massive water shutoffs are uniquely upsetting. Quote, we are deeply disturbed to observe the indignity people have faced and continue to live within one of the wealthiest countries in the world and a city that was a symbol of America's prosperity. An unprecedented 27,000 households have been disconnected from the pipes that sustain life and dignity, most of them black and poor, according to the observations, although the city doesn't bother to maintain records on race and income of those it casts into purgatory. The water department is deliberately blind to the shutoffs' disproportionate impact on low-income African Americans. It goes on to say later on at the end of the article, it says, high water bills and cascading shutoffs have added to the flood of forced evictions. Our conclusion, this is the United UN officials, is that you have here a Detroit man-made perfect storm. Then it says, more precisely, a corporate-made vortex of ethnic and class cleansing to make way for a new gentrified city. Just as the water shutoffs are unprecedented, so too is the pace of county home foreclosures, which have now targeted one of every five properties in Detroit. Wayne County is notifying 70,000 Detroit households that they have been caught up in the foreclosure frenzy. We have decided to foreclose on everything, said Wayne County Chief Deputy Treasurer David Szymanski.
Wow.
He claims the foreclosure proceedings are for the occupants' own good, since they might then be eligible for federal housing aid. That's a slap in the face.
Right.
We're taking your house, but we're going to give you housing aid.
We'll give you a voucher and we'll give you aid.
Detroit and New Orleans and Baltimore, three different branches of the same tree.
That's critical. Caller from the 704 area code. This is NMEMINDZ Radio. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
This is Don Trey from Charlotte. Peace, God. Peace, Goddess.
Peace to God. How you feel?
Man, you know how I feel. right now. But, I'm glad y'all are doing the show on this, man, because I'm dealing with this, you know, as you know, Griff, earlier.
Right. Wow.
You know, I want to promote, I really want to promote when we have black businesses, black-owned businesses in our community,
how important and key it is that we support these businesses. So what you're talking about, gentrification, doesn't take an effect on the business side of it, because that affects too as far as property owning. But the community where I stay at, like I told you last year, that they've been doing this for about 2 years, where they're tearing down what used to be projects, tearing them down, moving these Section 8 people out of the city and moving them outward, and all these white people are moving back into the city, which they moved from in the first place and moved us in the city, but now the city is getting big and pretty. They want to move back towards the city, so now they're moving all the black communities outward. Like, you could really see it. Like, these gated communities are part of a hood that you ain't never seen before.
Right.
It was 7-Eleven pop up out of nowhere. Like, really? You never said 7-Eleven like 2 months ago? Where did this come from? Because they got a gated community full of white folks right at the end of the block, where the hood is at. And we're like, what? And then they're giving out these vouchers. Like you say, people are already on Section 8. All they're doing is telling them they got to move.
Right.
We already got a house for you.
Well, and you know, John Trey, you made a great point. I watched a video. A sister was breaking down the science. Well, not the science, but she was talking about Baltimore, how everybody was crying and complaining about the CVS pharmacy being burned down. But literally right on the same block, there was a black-owned pharmacy that had been there forever, and CVS moving there basically damn near closed their business down.
Right.
So why should we be complaining about this big wig corporate giant who came in and ostracized the black business? Instead of doing that, we should be supporting the black business. Everybody in that area who, you know, needs to get anything from a pharmaceutical store should be going to that area. That's when you talk about revolution.
Right, exactly. Revolution is complete, constructive, conscious, cosmic change. We really appreciate you, John Trey. We're going to make it happen, bro.
Hold your head.
All right. Please, thank
Eagle
you.
Head up. All right, man, we'll talk.
Bruh.
Because I was Tupac. I thought you liked Tupac.
Love Tupac, but
not
sound
me.
Like, but well, you didn't.
Okay,
sound
thank you. I didn't sound like a, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Black people. See how y'all act? Caller from the 1111111111. This is Professor Griffin ZaZa Ali. What's your name? Where you calling from? Matter of fact, what computer are you calling from?
Hey, what's up?
What's going on, man? What's happening?
Hey, ZaZa, do you love your mother?
Is this Master Allah?
Yeah, Master
Simpleton Allah.
Simpleton. I don't know what I want to call him.
He hasn't been around. Did you cut him off?
He just got out of jail. I don't know what happened to him.
He just got out of bed with that white woman.
Yeah. All right, stop. Let's leave him alone, baby. But anyway, here we go. Where are we at? Call up from 773. Okay, M. Call me. Rolling the L. Maybe I had the wrong 773. Call from the 773 area code. What's good?
Peace, Queen of Kings.
Peace, Queen. How are you?
This is good. This is Maisha from Chicago. How y'all doing tonight?
All right,
Peace,
how are
Maisha
you?
From Chicago. How you doing, Queen?
I'm doing good. I actually have two personal experiences with this, one with my grandmother and one with my mom. My grandmother, she used to own her house, moved from Mississippi, you know, the migration, and she ended up losing it about three or four years ago, and I went on, like, one of the real estate, you know, sites just to see how much they were selling before, and they were selling it for $10,000. And somebody bought it, you know, hooked it up or whatever. And when my mom, she moved here, and my mom, she moved here from Milwaukee, and she was renting. And she was renting. And the area that she lived in was close to a university. She lived there about 5 years. They ended up raising the rent, the landlord told her. And she moved out to Indiana. Bought a house for $300 from the auction, and fixed it up. And now she's doing good. She said she planned on buying plenty more, you know. She said everybody moving out from out of there. You know, she said it's real dead out there. But she like she owns something. You know, she said she's tired of working. You know, so she like she owns something. So I'm like, that's what's up. And I'm glad y'all had this topic tonight.
Oh, give thanks, Maisha. Really
and that's
appreciate
a great
you.
Point. And that we should, with that, thank you so much, Craig,
right,
for your call.
You. All right.
And for
yep,
that perspective.
Yep.
Because we
thank
have
you.
To, of right. course, I know we want to take some more calls, but we definitely want to close this show out talking about, you know, the who, what, when, where, why as to how to stop this. I think we have to have vision. You know,
right.
we're going to have to go in and fix those abandoned buildings, and you may be the only business on the block. You know, we have to start being innovative in our thinking.
Right, exactly.
Crowdfunding is a great source. Mm-hmm. With, you know, like, I don't want to unite with everybody. I'm just going to keep it 100. I've said it before.
Like the dude that just called. I can't.
Like the
yeah.
clown that just called. Like the right. dude that was just on my page talking about, you know, your DVD will never compare mm-hmm. to Hidden Colors. We don't make, what are you talking about? And, yeah, anyway, I'm saying all of that to say, you know, get the people who you trust, whether it's 5, 10, 15, 30 of you, get together, do the numbers, do the math, and figure out how much money you need to save every month for the year, for 2 years, however long plan you need to come together to start buying land, buying
right,
property.
Exactly.
Going into these neighborhoods where these houses are $10,000, I've looked at some property in Detroit, in Baltimore, even in Atlanta. There's a house around the corner from here for $100,000. It's a beautiful home, but in California, you can't get nothing for $100,000.
Right, exactly.
So if you're in New York, if you're in California, if you're in certain parts of Florida or certain parts of the country where you're just being squeezed so tight, renting an apartment, barely making ends meet, using all your money to pay your bills, it's time to start rethinking.
Right, exactly. I'm going to take a couple more callers. Caller from 678 area code. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
What's going on, Brother Griff, Sister ZaZa? This is Aaron
Peace.
Calling from Clearwater, Florida.
How you feeling, good brother?
I'm feeling good. Feeling good. Missing home. As y'all in my home right now. I have uh-huh. the only personal experience I have, I guess, with gentrification is what I've seen there in Atlanta. Like you had mentioned earlier, with all the closing of the, you know, the projects and everything, they just went pretty much citywide, just closing them all down and shipping everybody out. Like you say, you know, I think we just got to do something to stay.
Yeah, I think the sister that just called gave the plan. She said, let's find these areas where it's kind of run down, loke up with one another, some like-minded people, and let's purchase some of these things. We just have to. Be patient and learn to live around one another. You
yeah,
know what I'm
yeah.
Something like that?
Yeah, like minds got to come together, you know, move in.
Right.
You got to speak to your neighbors, man. You got to speak to your neighbors, yep. man.
That's right.
All right, man. What's my
name? I
absolutely
agree.
Jimmy Rush.
Stop.
Jimmy Rush, don't even speak.
My name was Aaron, man. Hey, and one more thing, man. I'm trying to make sure I get plugged with the DVDs. I sent an email to the... what is it, Minds Matter, BT?
RS at gmail.com?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
All right, we got you.
Okay, bet. That's all pretty much, man. Y'all keep doing your work and giving your energy, man. It's much appreciated.
All right, peace.
Peace, King.
Peace.
That was Aaron calling from Clearwater.
Florida.
He said Clearwater. I'm looking for the 510 area code.
Bro, can we get Oakland in the building?
I got two calls from Oakland. 510 and 510. Caller from the 510 and caller from the 510. What's good with y'all? What's your name?
Hey, King. Oh. Hey, Queen.
I'm
from Oakland. I agree with you. If a few people got together, instead of working... And those who can't work, pull their money together, go into the neighborhood.
One of those persons. Buy
the property.
All right. Call it from the 510-363. What did you just say now? Repeat that.
Good evening, King and Queen. This is Connie from Oakland.
I agree
with the sister and brother before. We need to pull our money together and uplift the community. get those apartments, get them, renovate them, get the people in there, if they and police up our neighborhood, start businesses, and it could be a success, especially Oakland. And
you're right.
Good luck.
All right. Give thanks, Connie.
We
appreciate you. All right.
Yes, ma'am. I'll be home Friday.
we need some books circulating here and some DVDs.
I'm coming. We're trying to plan something for Oakland right now, for California now.
We definitely give you a good homecoming.
Okay, yes, ma'am.
All right. Zaza,
okay,
guys. All
thank
right.
You.
From the O. All
peace,
right.
Queen.
Peace. Peace. Sister
thank
Connie.
You. Peace.
All right. Peace. Hold on 1 second. Where's my other 51? Call from the 510 area code.
That's all. Greetings. How are you doing?
All right. How are you?
I'm blessed. Thank you. I just wanted to, like, the whole conversation about gentrification, just coming from Oakland and being a person that had to leave the community and come back to the community and reclaim the community, it's a task. And I would just implore other people, if you have the opportunity to come back to your city that you were raised in, to come back to the city. I'm a person that is working in art. And one of the biggest issues that we have is trying to, like, in Oakland, we're known for being artists. And one of the things that's been pulled from us is the artists we've been shunned, and we have to pay more to be a part of the whole scene. With the Fox Theater, you know, a part of that is, you know, we pay for that. The citizens pay for that. And so just I implore people, when it comes to gentrification, to support the artists, to support the business people in the community, and the ones that are
right.
Actually pushing for the arts.
Yeah, I would just say, you know, we are the arts.
Right.
You know,
serious.
You can do art on the Fox. You know, we have to find ways to get around. I mean, Fox Theater is like major. You know, there's so many different avenues. You know, we have brothers doing graffiti on cardboard boxes. The whole world is looking at our people right now for everything that is hip, that is fly, that is fashionable, that is worthy of attention. So they're going to come where we are. We just have to make it fly. We have to make it what it is.
Right.
Bump
right.
the Flock
yes.
Theater.
And one thing that I wanted to say is the people to look out for Kiss My Black Art is an art collective out of Oakland. We're working with various artists, and it's about Kiss My Black Art because, first of all, you can't have any color without black. So, if you know, you guys are going to see us, but Kiss My Black Art is what we're doing, and it's about youth entrepreneurship. And working our way around with all of this.
That sounds cool.
All right,
Queen.
Thank you
so much.
All right.
All right.
Peace, Queen. So, we talked about crowdfunding. We talked about, and this crowdfunding, not just to buy property, but you know, you got brothers and sisters around you that have business aspirations, that have things that they want to accomplish.
Right.
You
got to
start getting together and creating a plan. It ain't just about now going and asking somebody for a loan.
Right.
If you got a good plan and a good idea and you're internet savvy, you can raise $10,000 in a day.
Of course, you can make some money.
Now, they're going to take 8%, the crowdfunding, you know, people, so a lot for that. But sit down and actually talk about a real full-fledged business plan that will bring people in. Make a YouTube video. Get a Facebook page. You know, go out in the streets and start talking to people. Get flyers made. Pay that. How much you pay for 5,000 flyers?
200. But I got mine 5x5. But if you do a regular 4x6, you can get it for $150.
$200 for $150. Hit up Jamal of Foxy.
Right.
Have him make you some fly flyers. You know what I'm saying? We got to get creative. And stop thinking about, well, I can't get a loan, I can't get this, I can't get that. Nothing is out of your reach at this point.
Right.
But you got to own it.
Got to own it. Call it from the 954 area code. This is NMEMINDZ Radio. What's your name? Where you calling from? 954. You're not there. You're just listening. All right. Hold on for a second.
Right.
I am digging deep. No, I can't dig that deep. Hold on one second. No, I think I've dug deep enough. No, I haven't. Caller from the 254 area code. I don't even know where this is. Where is this? Des Moines, Iowa?
Hey, how you doing? Peace.
Peace. Where you calling from?
I'm calling from Texas.
Oh, okay. What part of Texas?
Killeen, Texas. I called Killeen, Texas. two weeks ago.
From Killeen, Fort Hood. All right.
Yes. That's fine, brother. Y'all. I'm just tuned in, you know what I'm saying? And the gentrification around here, this is a military post, so, you know what I'm saying, you can slightly see the change, but not as, like, a bigger city or something.
Right. Yeah, I think everything around there is centered around that, the military base, man. So you won't really see it, not as transient, kind of laden heavy with people coming and going, only there for 3 years and bouncing. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. A little off topic. The Jeb 15? I don't believe that's the name of it. I can't think of it right now. Jade Helm 15. I can kind of see some little symptoms coming around here. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to, you know what I'm saying, go off topic or anything, but kind of interesting, you know, with the weather and how the Bluebell ice cream went out of business and. Just a little interesting. I can kind of feel a little bit just being in Texas right now, though.
Oh, okay, cool. We'll keep our eyes open, man. Really appreciate you, man. Calling all the way from Killeen, Texas.
I just want to thank y'all. I've been following, you know what I'm saying, Red Pill, Blue Pill, Brother Rich, all of y'all. I'm taking all this information in slowly but surely, but it's been like a good year I've been following y'all.
Oh, and I thank y'all for what y'all do to me. All right.
You're looking out, brother.
Really appreciate you. All right, good brother.
No problem. Thank you.
All right, peace.
Hopefully you can make it to see us in Dallas June 28th.
More like Houston. He's a little bit close to Dallas. It's kind of out of the way for Killeen.
Okay.
Let me see. What's the sister name that the new commercial we have? The Crafts Woman commercial?
Yes.
She sent me a text message. I talked about the red, black, and green pyramid. She already made them. Oh, I can get a red, black, and green pyramid candle?
I didn't see any pictures of it, though, on the
website. Oh, no, she sent it to me.
Okay.
All right, well, you know, I'm just saying. You know what I mean?
Really? Brothers and sisters,
how you?
It's 9:53. We gotta close this out. But, you know, I love being around our people.
Yeah.
I love seeing our people everywhere I go. I don't have a problem with not seeing any other people. But we have to, I think, before we even start talking about rebuilding cities and communities, we have to rebuild our minds in the way that we think and stop thinking that their ice is colder than our ice.
Right.
And they can, you know, being around them or not being around our people is the best thing
for
us.
Right, exactly.
You know what you're going to get when you're dealing with our people.
Pretty much.
You don't know what you're going to get. When you start veering out the line, you can ask Trayvon Martin's family about that.
Watch the ID channel. Them people, boy.
Right, exactly. So, you know, we got to get tapped back into that higher self and just love and appreciate our people. I see, you know, brothers and sisters that don't have money or anything, and I can still see the beauty and the greatness in them.
Right.
That don't mean, you know, you might not have to have bars on your window. You might have to have bars on your window. You know what I'm saying? Be smart. But at the same time, this is how you build communities. We have to go back and start investing.
One day the bars will come off.
One day the bars will come off.
Yeah.
You heard the white woman in New Orleans. She said it was a rough place to live at first, but she's still there.
Right. That's the thing.
We have to be able to stick it out.
Stay the course.
Stay the course.
Right. You have a quote for this evening?
I do.
Can I give one of mine? Can I give another one?
You can.
Margaret Walker says, "How long have I been living in hell thinking it was heaven?"
Oh, wow. Say that again.
If you in the hood, you might think that you know, ghetto fab, hood rich, all that kind of stuff. She said, "How long have I been living in hell thinking it was heaven?"
Right. Wow. Gene Toomer said, "Acceptance of prevailing standards often means we have no standards of our own." That's along with something I wrote on my Facebook page about all these black people talking about this transgender dude and him being on the cover of Vanity or whatever magazine, Vogue it is, and y'all celebrating and congratulating this hybrid.
Right.
What are you doing? Get your mind right. Acceptance of prevailing standards, i.e. homosexuality, transgender, whatever you want to call it, often means we have no standards of our own. Get your weight up with your standards, people.
Right, exactly. And one last quote. Anger is no substitute for consciousness.
Yeah, that's real.
Just because you stay angry all the time, that don't mean you're conscious.
Yep.
Just because you stay angry at the system, at the white man, at whatever, that doesn't necessarily mean you're conscious. Your consciousness, right, your consciousness should override your anger. Mm-hmm. Your consciousness should elevate and help you move beyond your anger.
Yeah.
Some people say, well, do you hate white people? No, I understand white people.
Yeah.
That's how I'm able to maneuver through
mm-hmm.
and survive. Your consciousness also is supposed to help you rise above your emotion into a different thinking,
yep.
causing you to change your behavior.
Real quick, Brother Rich did a video earlier with paying homage to Delbert Blair. I'm going to put the video up on our YouTube channel, but the website is themetacenter2.com. That's themetacenter2.com. You can go there to get information about protecting yourself from low frequencies, i.e. cell phones, computers. Purchase the brother bills to support him right now. He is in the hospital. Also, his phone number, I'm assuming that we can call him directly because Brother Rich put the video up, is 708-828-4360. So I personally am going to call Baba Delbert Blair mm-hmm. tomorrow.
Okay.
But he put the phone number out there, so let's support the brother, and let's also go to his website because I'm sure that he needs financial assistance right now, paying him hospital bills and whatever else that
right.
he has to take care of in his life. So
right.
we send love and a positivity and well wishes, and we are willing him to be healthy and to be reinvigorated for this work that he was born to do.
Right. Let's all of us get together and galvanize our energy and our efforts and put behind our good brother, Dr. Delbert Blair. If you've never heard of the brother, all right, or your relatives and Tay-Tay and Man-Man and Twan and them, never heard of them, Day-Day and them, go find a clip on YouTube and send it to someone tonight. Put it up on your Facebook page. And let's ask everyone to support our brother, Delbert Blair. Minister Farrakhan is traveling around the country building much-needed support for the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March. It's happening October 10th. Are you going to participate in one of those meetings? Are you going to raise your vibration to the point where we get our people out and up so we can meet again and galvanize that energy so we can change the dynamic of what's going on in America with black people?
It's been a great show.
What are we talking about on Thursday?
College Con. We are going to explore the whole system of the whole idea of going to college. Is it still useful? We're going
right.
to deal with the reality of what most college graduates are facing, as well as talk about our own personal experiences.
Right.
Yeah, and is it a hustle? And if it's a hustle, why are we continuing to be hustled?
Yep. Professor Griff is in Fredericksburg, Virginia on June 18th. All right, that's a Thursday, June 18th, 2015, part of the Rising Legends event. Professor Griff, that was nice.
I thought that was you.
That wasn't me, that was you.
No, that's Delbert Blair's website.
I thought you did that on purpose,
the
I thought. I'll be at Central Station, 1917 Princess Anne Street, Fredericksburg, Virginia. I thought you did that on purpose.
I mean, you know.
As we sign out, this is Professor Griffin ZaZa Ali, y'all.
Peace.
Peace.